here we are, the last generation, the 10th episode, season 3 of Picard, the finale, my friends. It's been a long, exciting ride, but we are finally here. And believe me, this episode is just fantastic. It is so cinematic. I was on the edge of my seat throughout the bulk of this episode, and I think that all of you, if you have not seen this, will love it. It's nice what they have done, and it gives the next generation crew the farewell that they deserve. It also finishes up some story arcs from The Next Generation, as well as one in particular from Star Trek Voyager. But let's get into the review. The show opens with the Enterprise D warping back to Sector 001 to see if they can offer any assistance in trying to deal with the Borg. On the bridge, the crew listens to an urgent message from President Anton Chekhov, son of Pavel Chekhov, as he warns anyone approaching Earth to get away as fast as they can because the Borg have assimilated the young and have taken over the fleet, have destroyed the defense systems surrounding the Earth, and are in a full-scale attack against the Sol Station, which is the only defense that the Earth has against the Borg right now, and if it falls, Earth will be next. He tells everyone that hope is never lost, something his father would tell him. Hope is never lost, and there are always possibilities. Now, that is a Spock quote, but considering how Chekhov was mentored by Spock, it would be quite understandable how that particular line would be something he would say to his son. In the background, you can hear people defending the station with statements like, the shields aren't holding, I don't know how much longer we can hold, Mr. President, we need to get you out of here, and at that moment, the transmission is cut off. With the Federation ships surrounding Sol Station and taking out the orbital defenses is bad news, Riker just screams out, where the hell is the cavalry?
Emergency hails from both Federation and civilian ships have now gone silent. Apparently, we are the cavalry.
The fleet is being controlled by the Collective, a hive mind with a single voice. The Borg are here. Mr. Data.
Scanning, Captain.
If space dock falls, there'll be nothing standing between an assimilated fleet and Earth.
If Earth falls, everything falls. Every planet, every system.
The long-range sensors report that the Borg cube is at Jupiter, so they warp over there and hopefully try to stop this thing. So it turns out the Borg hid a cube inside the gas of the Jupiter through a transwarp conduit. They were able to put a transwarp conduit through the gases of Jupiter, which is pretty cool. The Borg cube is transmitting the Borg Collective, which is, again, an amazing thing from all the way from Jupiter to be able to reach Earth and all the people in the fleet.
It is confirmed. Your son is the command signal.
The only way to save the fleet and everyone on board those ships, as well as Earth, is to sever the connection between the Borg cube, Jack, and the rest of the fleet. And Picard vows that what it started 35 years ago is going to end, one way or another, tonight. Back at the fleet, Space Dock is just getting the living hell beat out of it, and they don't know how much longer they're going to be able to hold out. On the Titan, the assimilated sit there like the perfect drones they are, just attacking the station and getting ready to launch a massive assault on Earth. As for Seven and the rest of the crew that's not been assimilated, they're making their best effort to head for the bridge and see if they can take control back. And in probably one of the coolest scenes that I have ever seen in a Star Trek phaser fight, when Seven's phaser hits a crew member, an assimilated crew member, they're instantly transported to Transporter Room 1 and locked in there. With the assimilated crew locked up in the transporter room for the time being, now Seven and Rafi have to figure out a way of getting the ship back under control. Seven orders everyone to their stations, but this guy right here says, I'm no officer, I'm just a cook. And Seven says, you're a pilot. You're our pilot right now. We got to deal with this. And this goes back to episode one, where Seven felt like she wasn't really belonging in Starfleet because she had to put up with characters like Shaw and wasn't able to motivate and lead anyone the way she felt she could. And now she's got that perfect opportunity right here. The Borg cube is only operating at 36%, and all of its resources are being used to operate the hive mind. Deanna's never felt anything like this before. Quiet suffering is how she would describe it. And she also says that she can feel Jack, but he's just so consumed by the Borg and the collective. Worf wonders if there's even a possibility he's too far gone, but Beverly won't accept that, and Picard's going, he's there, we just have to get him out. So at that moment, the shields drop on the cube and the weapons move away from the Enterprise. And Picard realizes that the beacon, if they sever the beacon, destroy it, they can free up the collective, free everyone, and save not only Jack, but the fleet and everyone as well. And that is and must be their primary objective here. Picard decides he's going to go down there. Riker volunteers, and Worf does as well. His exact quote is,
I will make it a threesome.
Do you even hear yourself?
Captain.
Once on the cube, Worf and Riker's job will be to find and eliminate the beacon while Picard deals with Jack. When they beam aboard, they find that the ship is so quiet and that it's completely falling apart. Not only that, but there's drones that are eroding, just decapitated and look like they were, not decapitated, excuse me, they just look like they've been ravaged for parts. At this point, Picard decides that they gotta separate. Worf and Riker have gotta go take care of the beacon while Picard's gotta take care of Jack. But before they leave, Picard thanks Riker, because if it really wasn't for Will pushing Jean-Luc to get to know his son better, they never would have reached this point in their relationship, Jack and him. Jean-Luc finds Jack connected to the hive mind, giving directives to every Borg in the fleet. And then, of course, everyone's favorite queen shows up, and if you can see right here, she is not looking good. She's seen better days. Back on the Titan, they are detecting the Enterprise D in orbit around Saturn by the Borg cube. Seven of Nine figures right away that it's Picard and that he's going after the cube, so they gotta find a way to give him some time. So the fleet formation is a line of sight, so each ship sees each other, they're able to communicate and control each other. But how do you break free of that? Well, if you can't see the other ship, then they can't control you. Hence, the cloaking device. Seven tells everyone that it's got to be a hit and miss type thing, you know? Decloak, fire, cloak, decloak, you know, it's a cloak and dagger type thing. And they've got to be on their game because they don't have much time to play with it. Back on the cube, the Queen is telling her version of a horrific story where after Voyager released a pathogen into the collective and destroyed the hub transconduits, it left them completely trapped and unable to assimilate other worlds. The Queen being alone, unable to communicate with any other cube, and all the other copies of her perished, and she was the last one, watching all of her children die off, leaving her alone. Just mind-ripping. It was an unspeakable darkness for her until she heard Jack's voice calling to her, and they wound up connecting. The Borg's future is no longer in assimilation, but in evolution now, which explains why she went after the fleet like she did. Riker and Worf locate a terminal where they can pull up the ship's schematics and transmit the beacon's location to the Enterprise. Picard is starting to realize the Queen has gone insane. She cannibalized her own drones, and she even acknowledges that, but there was a purpose behind that, just so she could get to this point in time and watch him suffer. She invited him there to suffer and see his future die. Unfortunately, back on the Titan, the assimilated crew is breaking free. Meanwhile, the Titan's decloak fire cloak plan is working, but again, there's only so long that they're going to be able to hold out before something happens. Now that they have a biological way of assimilation, their goal now is to not only assimilate, but destroy any race that gets in their way and denies assimilation. Just before Riker and Worf can transmit the coordinates to the Enterprise for the beacon, a drone wakes up and starts attacking them. And this one's a little painful for me to say, but Worf, being the master of the sword and the Batleth like he is, he can't seem to hold his own too well with this drone. And at the same time, the Enterprise is starting to take fire. Now, I love this part right here where Riker attempts to pick up the sword to help Worf, but he tells him, no, get the laser gun in the middle of the sword. Pulls it out and he looks at him, you had a laser gun this whole time. And Worf goes, the sword is more fun. And with that, Riker takes him out. The cube is continuously attacking the Enterprise, so Geordi informs the Doctor that the tracking system or the manual automatic targeting system isn't working. She's going to have to do it manually. And with that, Beverly just basically wipes out the cube's weapons array.
A lot's happened in the last 20 years.
The schematics for the beacon and the cube have been received. However, there's a serious problem. The beacon is in the middle of the cube. And Geordi's even saying not even his own kids could pilot their way into this. But Data's going, I've got this. Let me do this. They fight him at first, but he just has a fit. Please trust me.
My gut tells me I can do this.
Your gut?
Yes.
You've got to be sure, Data.
Please, everyone, just trust me.
And with that, Data takes the Enterprise right into the cube itself. I think he's been watching too much Return of the Jedi. He sure seems happy about it, doesn't he? And the one thing I never thought I would ever see, Space Doc has fallen. And with Space Doc gone, the Federation fleet, or the Borg fleet now, is targeting every major city on Earth. And to make things worse, the crew that escaped from the transporter room has ripped out the cloaking device, which makes them now a target again. They've located the beacon, but now they've got a major problem on their hands. If they fire, it will destroy the cube. Not just the beacon, but the cube. Everyone on the cube will die. So they got a choice, the cube or everyone else. So, reluctantly, they call Riker and let him know what's going on. And he's like, give me a few minutes. You do what you gotta do, but give me a few minutes because I gotta go save Picard. Deanna's like, if we do this, if we fire on that, you've got maybe at the minute at the most before you will die. And Riker says, I owe Picard a lifetime. I can give him a minute.
There was a moment today where I was worried we might actually survive.
So now Picard starts disconnecting Jack from the cables, but the Queen informs him that the only way that Jack's going to get out of this is if Jack is willing to leave the collective on his own. Disconnecting his mind will just utterly destroy him. He's got to be willing to leave on his own. Picard tells the Queen that he's been running from the collective for half of his life, and that he promised himself he would never ever come back to this place. But now that Jack is in his life, he's got something to go back home to fight for. He removes a connection point from Jack and plugs it right into him, connecting him to the hive mind. Once inside, Jack tells him, isn't it lovely in here? All the voices are so welcoming and friendly. There's no violence. There's no war. It's just peaceful in here. Never mind all the hell he's creating outside in the real world. He tells Jack the reason he joined Starfleet was to be part of something, to be part of a family. But he realized that even on that vineyard, he was going to die alone, and it wasn't until he met Jack that he realized how much he needed purpose beyond Starfleet. Basically, a family. Jack gave him that family. Jack doesn't want to go. He believes that destiny, fate, whatever the cards may have dealt him, he pretty much believes that this is where he's meant to be. Unfortunately, they can't wait any longer. They fired him. They're getting the hell out of there. Picard tells Jack that he's changed his life forever and proceeds to hug him. If he's not going, then he's staying with Jack. At that moment, Jack starts having flashbacks to all the times they had on the Titan, all the good times, the bad times, and just suddenly realizes he's got a family and he doesn't want to be here. He wants to get the hell out. Deanna is suddenly able to feel where they are and guides the Enterprise right to them. The Borg Queen is obviously not happy about the situation. She tells Jack that you will now live an endless life of loneliness and sorrow. Your life will never be the same again now that you have connected to the Hive Mind. And Jack just simply tells her, I got a family now and I'm going home and it is time for the Borg to die. Their time is up. And at that moment, the Enterprise appears and beams them out of there. And with that, the Borg Queen screams out her last breath, considering she's the last one, and the Borg cube explodes. And that is the end of the Queen. Now that the beacon is gone, everyone starts returning to normal. But now think about this. Jean-Luc had a problem with Wolf 359 and what he did. Imagine what all these people are going to have to live with for the rest of their lives. They killed their mentors. They killed people they loved. They destroyed the orbital platforms and space dock. Psychiatry bills are going to be expensive for this. And with everyone back on the Enterprise, lots of hugs going around. It was a good scene, and I actually enjoyed the heartfelt warmness of the whole thing. And now, Beverly has been promoted to Admiral, Admiral Crusher, in charge of the medical branch of Starfleet, and has found a way to reverse the damage done by the Borg through the transporters, and at the same time, has found a way to detect changelings. So apparently one of the things that happened here is the changelings did not kill the people they were imitating. They kept them hostage. But now the real Admiral Tuvok is pretty much lecturing Seven of Nine about what she did, how she helped Picard and Riker hijack the Titan, and what to be done with her. Seven, rather than the fear of a court-martial, just basically says, I don't fit in Starfleet, and I am going to resign. I request permission to give in my commission. Before Picard and Riker took the ship on a great adventure, Shaw had apparently been doing crew reviews, and he left some interesting information about Seven.
That leads me to First Officer Hanson. More accurately, Seven of Nine. Now, I'm a relic of an older time. By the book, by God, the book is boring. Hanson is reckless. She's unrelenting. Doesn't give a damn about protocol or procedure. However, she is brave and loyal, and the book that she writes is going to be great. And the rules that she breaks, maybe they were broken to begin with. So, in light of that, I have a recommendation, promotion to captain when we return to port.
And on that, Tuvok tells her, your request to step down is denied, captain. Rafi's son, Gabe, now wants her to meet her granddaughter. And basically, that's because Worf hijacked the internet feed and sent classified documents to him, pretty much showing off what she's done to save the galaxy. He is quite the honorable Klingon. As for Counselor Troy and Data, apparently they're going through some long psychiatric evaluations. And the Enterprise D takes her rightful place in the Fleet Museum. And this right here is a beautiful shot. Probably one of the last times we will ever see LaForge, Picard, and Riker on the bridge of the Enterprise D. Sometime later, we see Picard, Beverly, and Jack, who's in a Starfleet uniform and apparently has gone through a fast-paced Academy training program and is now on his way to his first assignment. Jack is to serve on the Titan, or is he? The Enterprise G. The Titan has been changed to the Enterprise NCC-1701G. Now, what I failed to mention to you before, and I apologize, is that this is taking place a year after the incident with the Borg. And in command of the Enterprise G is Captain 7 of 9, First Officer Raffi. Jack's assignment is Special Counselor to the Captain. And the Enterprise G boldly goes where no one has gone before. The next few scenes we have here are the crew at the guidance bar. It's a very nice scene, very relaxed. It's nice to see them all having a good time. Now, this is probably one of my favorite scenes from this whole episode.
There was a young lady from
Data.
Always wanted to finish this.
And in the last scene with the crew, they're at a table playing poker like they used to do on the Enterprise. Now, in an extra scene toward the end of the credits, we find Jack on the Enterprise, unloading his baggage, putting a picture of Picard and Beverly together. To me, the picture looks like they were married, which means that Picard left Laris behind. But there's another reason for this image, this scene. Q is back. Everyone thought he was dead. Jack says to Q, "My dad told me all about you. I thought you were dead." The next line is just priceless. Q looks at him and says, "Here, I thought the next generation was not so linearly." So basically, Q tells Jack that Picard's time, his trials are over, but Jack's are just about to begin. And that, my friends, was my review of Picard Season 3, Next, The Last Generation. It was a very good episode, my friends, and it was nice to see the crew go out with some dignity and class. And I love how they tied in what Janeway did in the last episode of Voyager to this episode here, and how the damage that was done to the Borg. It was just amazing to watch this episode, and I really recommend this season. It doesn't help seasons 1 and 2, but this season was fantastic. The one thing I'm also happy about is the fact that Q did not die. I am a big fan of Q, and he is what helped make The Next Generation so popular. Well, I'm going to end my review right here, my friends, but I hope you've enjoyed it. And until the next time, drop your comments below and let me know what you think. And next time, God bless.